It's one of the most iconic sequences in all of film. The evil Galactic Empire takes the captured princess to her home planet, a world not so different from Earth, threatening to destroy it.
I want you to think about this for a second. A battle station about a quarter the size of the moon, with an unexplained power source, fires a laser beam at a planet the size of Earth and completely destroys it.
Not only does the Death Star completely destroy Alderaan from the force of the blast, it does so in a matter of seconds and kicks off at least a substantial part of the planet into space.
From a physics point of view, how much energy and power would it actually take to cause this level of destruction? And what kind of physical possibilities are there out there to actually accomplish it?
First off, let's consider the planet Earth and the force binding it together. As Obi-Wan famously said, it surrounds us and penetrates us, it binds the galaxy together. But the force binding the Earth together isn't the mysterious one from the Star Wars universe, it's simply gravitation. And the gravitational binding energy of our planet, which is the minimum amount of energy that we'd have to put into it to blast it apart, is an astonishing 224 million septillion joules. To put that into perspective, it would take a full week's worth of the sun's total energy output delivered to an entire planet in the span of a few seconds to cause that type of reaction.
Remember what actually happens in a sun-like star?
Hydrogen is burned via the process of nuclear fusion into heavier isotopes and elements, resulting in helium. Each second in the sun, 4.3 billion kilograms of matter is converted into pure energy, which is the source of the sun's energy output.
Let's imagine that's exactly what the Death Star is doing.
We could simply have the Death Star fire a beam of light into the planet. This would be catastrophically inefficient, however. Imagine a solid material structure, even one as big as our moon, trying to generate, direct, and expel all that energy in just a matter of a few seconds. Releasing that much energy in one direction would cause a moon mass object to accelerate in the opposite direction to a speed of 78 kilometers per second from rest, something that clearly didn't happen when the Death Star was fired. In fact, there was no discernible recoil at all.
But there's another way this planetary destruction could have happened, and it's based on one assumption. Princess Leia is made of matter.
Since she's made up of matter and grew up on Alderaan, we can assume Alderaan is made of matter as well, meaning that if the Death Star instead fired pure antimatter, it would only need to supply half the total energy, since the target would provide the other half. If this were the case, only 1.24 trillion tons of antimatter would be suffice to provide the minimum amount of energy needed to blast that world apart. In the grand scheme of things, that's not so big. For example, an antimatter asteroid with the same density of Earth would only need to have a diameter of about 7.5 kilometers to do the job.
It's not completely inconceivable to think that we can collect this much antimatter.
We've been able to create neutral antimatter and store it successfully for reasonably long periods of time, long enough that it's only our failure to keep normal matter away from it that causes it to annihilate in such short order. It isn't unreasonable that an advanced technological civilization, one that's mastered hyperdrive and faster-than-light travel, could harness, say, the energy from an uninhabited star and use it to produce neutral antimatter.
The way we do it on Earth is we collide one proton with another proton at high energy and speeds. What you get are three protons and one antiproton. That antiproton can combine with a positron to produce a neutral antihydrogen.
In the interiors of gas giants like Jupiter and Saturn, the incredibly thick hydrogen atmosphere extends down for tens of thousands of kilometers. Whereas the pressure on Earth's atmosphere is around 100,000 pascals, at pressures of tens of gigapascals, hydrogen can enter a metallic phase, something that should no doubt happen in the interiors of gas planets.
If we could achieve this state of matter, we could use hydrogen as a conductor. It's believed that that is what's responsible for Jupiter's intense magnetic field.
All of the laws of physics suggest that if this is how matter behaves, and we can do this with hydrogen, then this must also be how antimatter, and hence anti-hydrogen, behaves too. So all it would take, if you want to destroy a planet about the size of Earth, is a little over a trillion tons of metallic anti-hydrogen, and to transport it down to the planet's surface. And as matter and antimatter annihilate according to E equals mc squared, the result is the release of pure energy.
Anyways, guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. That's just a quick look at exactly how the Death Star could possibly be implemented in our type of universe. This video was actually written by Ethan Siegel. He's a fantastic writer. This was actually a blog post over at his website. You can go check that out, as well as his book and his Patreon. Those, again, will be linked down below. Anyways, guys, if you were in charge of the Death Star, would you use it for good or would you use it for evil? Let me know in the comments down below. Anyways, guys, leave the video a like and make sure you set notifications to on. Anyways, guys, thanks for watching.